27-year-old Daniel Fazina never saw it coming.
I developed strange sensations in my chest. It eventually turned into pain, and it was radiating down my right side into my arm.
He drove himself to the emergency room. The doctor ordered x-rays and CT scans.
The doctor came back and he said, well, we found something, and it's a rather large mass in your chest. And I asked him, well, how large is rather large? And he said, it's grapefruit sized. And he said, this is very serious. You need to get it evaluated immediately. I had to go get a biopsy. And, you know, it took about a week or so to get the results. And when the doctor called me, it was, as he feared, lymphatic cancer. It was shocking. It was surreal. Didn't quite sink in at first. Getting that news after having never been sick before in my life, it was almost like I was starring in an episode of The Twilight Zone. It was that surreal.
Daniel called his girlfriend, Sahani, who was a med student.
It was definitely shock. And, you know, you hear the word cancer and you just automatically associate it with death and dying and end of life. His tumor was so large that when he had shown me his PET scan, I had looked at it and I said, oh, well, that's your heart. And he goes, actually, no, that's my tumor.
It wasn't the cancer itself that was the threat. It was the actual physical size that was the threat. It was crushing this major artery.
We kind of were forced to go through chemo. And the way the doctors said, you know, we're going to give you a form of chemo that is relatively a palliative form. We don't expect that you're going to get better, but you have to do something.
They weren't sure if it was going to respond, but without it, he said I would be dead within a matter of 3 weeks to 3 months.
It was crushing his pulmonary artery, which means his lungs were not getting blood, which means there was no oxygenated blood going to the rest of his body. So he was literally suffocating to death because of this tumor.
Daniel started his six-month regime of various types of chemo.
My whole body was just in pain, almost like burning on the inside of me. I was too weak to walk. You know, your GI tract and your gums, everything gets sore.
He couldn't keep anything down and he was just dry heaving to the point where he was probably vomiting bile because it was green. My heart just broke for him because I was like, gosh, I was like, God, I will take his place. Just let me do anything I can to take his suffering away. And there is nothing, you know. And you try to have faith that there's going to be glory that's going to come out of it, but you don't in that moment. You just don't. So those were some dark moments.
Friends and family visited Daniel in the hospital.
I had so many people praying for me. I had people prophesying to me, saying this thing was born to die. It's going to be a testimony to the Lord.
Just praying for him and for us and for his parents. And you just felt the whole week like they were there with you. You know, you just felt like there were angels praying for you the whole time. You just felt their presence, and it was amazing.
People anointed me with oil and praying over me, both in the hospital and after I got out. And I remember the pastor saying, you need to just cry out to God and let him know that you need him. And because I was really holding everything inside, and it was at that point when my friends were laying hands on me in the church, I just got down on my knees and just the floodgates opened. I was crying hysterically, just crying out to God, saying, God, I need you, I need you. And I had never done that before. That was a big step for me.
Daniel went back to the hospital for his next treatment.
The tumor had gotten bigger. It was crushing my pulmonary artery. I was suffocating. And I remember being in the hospital bed, literally dying. And I remember just looking up to God and saying, you know what? If you want to take me, I'll go with you. I know I'm your child. Your word says that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and I believe that. But I said, if you want to heal me and let me live, I'll just do my best to share with the world your goodness, your grace, your love, your mercy, your power. And that was really a turning point for me, learning to let go and to just trust the Lord.
Daniel went in for tests at the midway point of his chemo.
Halfway through the treatments, when they took that second scan, which they were just hoping the tumor would be smaller, and it came back completely negative, like just gone. I remember walking out of the radiology place, it was just before Christmas. I'm looking up to heaven. It was a beautiful day, crystal clear blue sky, and just tears raining down my eyes, just saying, thank you, Lord. Thank you. It was the best Christmas gift I ever had.
that does not happen. I mean, I saw that tumor, it was ginormous. And I said, this doesn't just go away. Well, not only was it not there, there wasn't even scar tissue. Usually when tumors retract, there is some type of scar tissue that's left behind. And there wasn't anything.
Words can't even describe the feeling. I mean, walking on air, coming out of this place, holding this picture in my hand of a completely normal PET scan, whereas 3 months earlier, I had this ominous tumor threatening my very life. Words can't describe the feeling, you know, being able to tell my family and my friends that I'm gonna be okay. It was just amazing.
Daniel and Sahani married in 2003. Sahani graduated from med school in 2007. Today, she's a podiatrist. And Daniel is the producer and host of Divine Intervention, a popular radio show about modern-day miracles.
It was the faith of my friends and my family who came around me and just girded me up and prayed for me. And I'm reminded all the time of the story in the Gospel of Mark, I believe it is, where the four friends are carrying the paralytic friend to Jesus, and they have to go through the crowd, and they have to go up on the roof and lower him down because of the crowd. And it says that when Jesus saw their faith, he healed the paralytic. I don't know whether the paralytic had faith or not, but I know his friends did. And sometimes that's what you need. You need people around you to really gird you up, pray for you, and bring you into the presence of Jesus. And that's what happened in my case.